to gather here this evening to celebrate what last Saturday was the 175th anniversary of the abolition of slavery in the British Empire in 1834 on August the 1st. We have a wonderful group of people here this evening to help us celebrate, and we're going to be welcoming some international guests who've come here to help us celebrate. I want to say that I just pulled down off the off my email the fact that today the United States Senate passed a resolution, a very long and complex resolution, but the nub of the resolution was the United States Senate celebrating the 175th anniversary of the abolition of slavery in the British territory. And part of the quote in that was from Frederick Douglass, who said, "What an incredible impetus the abolition of slavery in the British territories was to the abolition movement in the United States." And so although we may say, and it's always important to say, that the world didn't all of a sudden become purified of evil on August the 1st, 1834, nonetheless, what an incredible step forward for all of us as humanity that slavery was abolished in such a wide section of the world at that time. It's truly something to celebrate. And we have, with Black Freedom 175, gathered together a whole wonderful collection of visiting vessels and visiting drummers and dancers and performances, musical concerts by our own African Nova Scotian performers, wonderful gospel concerts, a play by students of a young woman, an extraordinary young woman who is the poet laureate of Halifax. Please welcome.
And how y'all doing?
Shauntay Grant.
Good, good, good. I'm very, very pleased to be part of this evening's event, and hadn't planned to say anything, but I guess John had other plans, so he asked me to share a piece that I'd written for a welcome for the Amistad, which I read on August 1st. It was a welcome to the ship just out here as part of the Natal Day festivities. So I told him I'd come with that poem and read it. But before I do that, he'd asked that I give just a bit of an overview about the project that I'm working on with an extraordinary group of young women who are all seated at the back there, and you'll get to hear from them a little later on. Yes, I did say extraordinary when I talked about y'all. This project is called HOME, an African Nova Scotian Youth Perspective. And what we've been doing over the past month, because we've really only been together since July 10th, is we've just been talking about community and history and our sense of home here in Nova Scotia as Black women in Nova Scotia. They've been telling stories from their communities. We've been having writing excursions and trips. We've gone down to Africville, and they've been writing about the experience of being there in that particular community. And they've turned that piece, their own poems about Africville, into a performance piece, which those of you who will be at Alderney Landing Theater tomorrow evening, you'll get to see that. And just talking about the sense of home and the sense of place and what it's like growing up here and having that sense of community and not having that sense of community at times through whatever circumstances we go through as people of African descent growing up in this society. A lot of really interesting and powerful discussions have come out of it, and some really great poems from some young women who have come into this program, not all of them calling themselves poets. Some of them, you know, even said to me, "I'm not a poet," you know. And but you'll hear that they all are, because they've all been doing some incredible work. So our project is called Home in African Nova Scotian Youth Perspective, and the pieces you'll hear from them all relate to this sense of home and place here in Nova Scotia. As I say this, I probably should have read my piece first before I did that long, rambling introduction. So let me back up a bit and talk a bit about the Amistad and do this piece called A Song for Sengbe. Her water broke, and a slippery fetus turned child pushed his way through dark belly towards freedom. Black the people, red the blood, green the land. His earth mother rooted him deep, grew him from soil and sand, wave and shore. He suckling coconut milk and wearing the many colors painted round about him. Son of the moon, he was the coast. The push and pull of two wonders stretched his skin, and like tide rolling away from sand, he grew to remarkable proportions. Destined for greatness, born to lead, he was Poseidon and Mandela wrapped in one spirit. His wave moved people to look and extend that blip on the page of some history book, building a legacy of purpose, justice, and splendor. Birth a schooner named Freedom that begs we remember. Sengbe Pie, son of moon, husband, a father, shackled from Sierra Leone to Cuba on the Tacora, Cuba to America on the Amistad, marked as cargo. He and others packed like sardines on a vessel not meant for thrashing arms and legs, but packed tight amongst kegs of sugar, industry products, and more. Black, breathing bodies pressed tight to the floor, branded, bruised, marked for sale next door while she was selling seashells by the seashore. Yet, amidst overwhelming indifference and binding combination, an epic sale would be born. And she would speak without saying, and chart waters for teaching, and bear witness to children, and reclaim the true meaning of friendship, amistad. Friendship, amistad, freedom vessel, thank you for your labor and your lessons. Thank you for embracing our youth and encouraging difficult questions. You are inspiration, a pillar poised with purpose paints the pier, and we are grateful and bid you welcome, for you are always welcome here. Thank you so much. Now I'd like
home is where I know I can get a full rest without being disturbed. Home is where I know I can get a good cooked meal that will stay with me. Home is where I know when I walk through the door, I can feel the warmth and the love when someone hugs me. And when I want blueberries, I can just go in back of my field and get some. Or when I want fresh rhubarb, I can just ask my uncle, because he always has something growing. My home has so many memories and stories of people who settled here and there. And my home may not be a 7-bedroom, 4.5 bath with 15-acre land, but it's my home. My home is East Preston.
Home. Home is where my heart, soul, and best part of my whole life is. Where the dirt's clean and green apples rule. Home is loud when she echoes her past. Don't be fooled. Old houses will speak to you. Weymouth Falls, Nova Scotia is truly my only consistent destination. Where my people come from. A community, independence. A place I've defended since my first memory of Graham's fuzzy green staircase. Home is a place to pick ras, black, blue, and strawberries. Ticks and mosquitoes eat you alive. You survive. Bears, coyotes, bobcats, and coons don't know if you're a threat to them or them to you. Home. Home is up and down the road, before the church or after. Fish frying, pies baking, and waiting impatiently for Graham's homemade chow. Home is salt pork, salt beef, salt fish, and sweet, sweet well water. Bread or fried bologna and molasses, hand me one of those glasses. This water is so good. Wake up to wood stoves and a treasure trove of food. Breakfast is ready, dinner is cooking. Looking back, there were more good times than bad. And now, I'm glad you came with me to see sunsets we'll never forget, a visit very few regret. Thank you for coming home.
I just wanted to take one more minute to say a huge thank you to John Henegrishu and Lou Gannon as well for your invitation to come down here and for these youth to showcase here. Yeah, really appreciate it. And also a huge welcome to our special guest visiting from Charlestown, Jamaica. Just wanted to give you a piece of Nova Scotian culture and really looking forward to hearing and learning from you all as well. Thank you all very much.
Guys, these kids, wow. I think you have to have a certain measure of freedom to discover your voice. And part of what we're celebrating tonight is how people in the African Nova Scotian community have discovered their voices. And it's magic, isn't it? Just magic. Someone who certainly has discovered his voice is Marco Simmons. Marco's going to play. Fred Weir, who's back in the back row, who was president of the Waterfront Development Corporation, and Wayne Adams, who's here, talked about, wouldn't it be wonderful to bring Amistad to Nova Scotia as part of the Tall Ships? And it didn't work for the 2004 Tall Ships, and so they started meeting with Brian Johnson and Henry Bishop from the Black Cultural Center, and Ken Pinto and I were added into this group. And we really worked to try to figure out how to get Amistad here, because we had a sense that there was some connection with the history of our community. And it just never seemed to work out. And finally, Greg Ballinger, who is now the CEO, President and CEO of Amstead, read a book by Simon Sharma called Rough Crossings, which talked about the whole story of the black loyalists from the south of the United States in slavery to fighting with the British in the revolution and being defeated and brought to Nova Scotia and not getting everything that was promised here and then going off to Sierra Leone and founding Freetown. And this opened Greg Bellinger's eyes and the eyes of the board of Amistad, and they said, Nova Scotia, they've been trying to get us to come there. We got to go. Their story is our story, and it's interrelated. They're interrelated freedom stories in so many ways. And so over the time, we gathered people together, and my twin brother here, Wayne Adams, you can all see the resemblance, eh?
John keeps talking about this twinship and different mothers and twin brothers, but I'll also add, John, there's different fathers too. Nonetheless, we are connected in a good way. We've enjoyed the rendezvous, if you will, over the past 5 years in terms of the Amistad Freedom Society of Nova Scotia. We've enjoyed the camaraderie, and we've enjoyed the heavy lifting and the tough pulling that we've done together to pull together events year in and year out. I want to recognize some members of the Amistad Freedom Society of Nova Scotia. You heard from the co-chair, John Hinnegar-Shu, and I'll recognize Mr. Lou Gannon, who is in the audience. Gilbert Day, I think Gilbert's here. Irving Carvery, down the back, Dr. Henry Bishop, Brian Darrell, Tracy Jones, Ken Pinto, Dr. Sharon Oliver, and Bev Cox. Bev has enjoyed sailing on the Amistad at one of her sails across the Atlantic. So I want to recognize those, I was going to say brave members, but members nonetheless of Amistad Society of Nova Scotia. I want to commend you for the work you've done and will keep on doing, hopefully, in the seasons and years to come. I want to take this moment right now to thank the sponsors of Black Freedom 175. We want to recognize our title sponsor, which is Eastlink. And Eastlink has been with us from the day we first broke the idea of having the Amistad come here on a regular basis, or at least once, and to share each other's history, because our history is their history, or its history, and its history is our history. But Eastlink, we recognize the stalwartness and the kinship we've developed with Lee Bragg and members of his senior staff. We want to thank the Halifax Regional Municipality and the Halifax Dartmouth NATO Day Committee. They have been with us since year one of the Amistad Freedom Society and doing joint ventures with NATO Day and the Freedom Society, particularly the Gospel Concert and the Halifax Waterfront and the big NATO Day tent every NATO Day Sunday. We thank the Canadian Heritage for their contributions and ongoing support, Dartmouth Chrysler Jeep Dodge, the Atlantic Pilotage Authority, and of course the Maritime Museum of the Atlantic, in which we now sit and stand and enjoy this environs. They have supported this project in so many essential ways across the years, and we look forward to an ongoing relationship. At this time, we're going to call back the second group of Shauntay students. This time, we're going to hear from Regine Boudreau and Jasmine Hudson. So put your hands together and welcome these young people. Thank you very much.
I am somebody. I believe in myself. Growing up in Truro, on the island, playing nowhere to run in soccer, baseball, running up and down the street, or driving our bikes, imagining they were cars. Young and old people from down the marsh and up the hill coming to play and to have a good time because the island was the place to be. Playing basketball, dancing and singing at special events, being young and having fun. I can achieve anything I set my mind to. Sunday school at Zion Baptist every Sunday. Saturday school every Saturday at the YMCA. Tutoring programs and so much history to be learned. I am proud of who I am and where I come from. Little Truro, small community full of big hearts. Being a family, even if no relation, neighbors being like my fake grandparents, spoiling us. Apex Golf Tournament, Stan Maxwell Playground, weddings and dances, standing out as the Truro girl, and being recognized by where I am from.
Okay, my poem's called I Am From. I am from Cherry Brook, going to Mr. Edwards' extra help and singing in my church choir. I am from studying all day, headaches from exams, clubbing with my girls, and bumping music in my ears. I am from basketball hoops and old sports gear, the overblasting music out of my room and little Bow Wow and Iverson pictures. I am from riding my bike and going to the fort. I am from eating lots of candy and going to the community store. I am from crying babies and wet diapers, hollering and screaming and running around the house. I am from fried chicken and soul food, my grandmother cooking all day so yummy in my tummy and sitting around the table talking. I am from get off the phone to mind your own business, from staying in a child's place to shh, the baby's sleeping. I am from being an athlete to being a friend, photos of me and my family and childhood memories. I am from Cherry Brook.
Wow. See, the people who know how to dress are over here. And we're so delighted that this wonderful troupe of drummers and dancers are with us here. And we want to welcome you from the bottom of our hearts. We're really pleased to be able to welcome the Charlestown Colonel of the Maroons, Colonel Frank.
Champong Nani, Komsikim Bebwa. I want to thank you all for affording us this incredible experience. Today was an extraordinary experience for us all sailing on the Amistad. And before calling and introducing you to each of these drummers and dancers who in themselves are spectacular and as a group they explode, I would like to share with you an experience. Today in a workshop, we spoke about that small thing, a nail, that the leader found and was able to free himself and free the rest of his mates, which led to the incredible journey of the Amistad. We discussed the power of that nail and the idea struck my consciousness with the force of law. And I challenge each and every one of us here to look in our lives, to look in our experiences, to see what nails have come our way that we have not taken advantage of, not knowing where they could lead. And so, whenever we find that nail, to have the courage to make the most of it and bring it to light. Cashay Richards, come. dancer, Marcia Douglas. Storyteller, drummer, dancer, Kerry Richards, Kerry Bryan. Dancer. Now I have a problem with the drummers because I know they're nice and their regular names are not as interesting as their nickname. Gregory Henry. Alias Blacks, drummer. Andre White. Alias Dreddy. Delana Douglas. Who is a captain in the Maroon Council and the lead drummer and the leader of this drumming group. Dwayne Christie. One of a twin, so it's easy just to call them Twinny. Dwight Christie. And Rodney Rose. This is a mixture of two Maroon communities, Scotshall and Charlestown, though we all live in Charlestown. This is a mixture of those two communities. We are part of the Windward Maroons. The Windward Maroons all fought out of Old Crawford Town after the fall of Nanny Town and prior to the signing of the treaty. After the signing of the treaty, we then split to Moortown, Charlestown, and Scotshall. And you will see them in performance in the tomorrow and the time coming. And this experience for these young men who will be, I'm sure, ambassadors for Jamaica. And I would be remiss in mentioning that the Excellency, the High Commissioner of Jamaica for Canada, found that nail and dared to make that nail go where it led. This is the result of that. Thank you.
My name is Andre, as you heard the Colonel, and I just want to dedicate this song for all of the Maroons that are left their hometown and gone far away, thinking that nothing can come out of it.
Kamafie, selebembe, kamafie, selebembe. Kama fiye ya, selebembe, kama fiye, kama fiye.
Kama fiye means come back home. Selebembe means nothing has changed. Kama fiye, come back home.
African Nova Scotian Affairs and the African Nova Scotian Music Association have done an incredible amount to make the visit of the Charlestown Maroon drummers and dancers possible. And they would like to thank, in particular, Western Union, the Black Business Initiative, and the Council of African Canadian Education, who, along with African Nova Scotian Affairs, have contributed the financial wherewithal to make this possible. And I want to tell you, tomorrow night at Alderney Landing, Friday night at the Black Cultural Center, and Saturday night at the Citadel High School in the atrium, you got to see it. Shauntay grants extraordinary students, Natasha Thomas and Nicole Brown.
Hello, everybody. Me and Nicole are going to be doing our pieces on our grandmothers because to us, that is where our home is from. This is my piece.
Gotta be quiet back there.
I look in your eyes, I see stars of visions, and when I look at the sun, I see your smile that took every tear from my eye. I feel warmth in the ear, and I know it's just you giving me a hug. I look in those deep brown eyes, and I see my ancestors moving strong. I feel your smooth caramel skin, and I know I got beauty deep within. I feel your rich, rough hands, and I know it is the strength and the power that you build up throughout the years. I hear your sweet voice echoing in my ear, telling stories of my childhood and yours. You were a strong Black woman that showed you cared. A strong Black woman that had no fears. A strong Black woman that spoke up for her rights. A strong Black woman that used her power and strength to raise her family with love and care. A strong Black woman that lives on through me and our family. Thank you.
Oh, sweet and happy scenes, the days of which I dream, when memories are calling now and then. Oh, and then, in rapture sweet, my buried heart would beat if I could hear my mother pray again.
As I hear this song, I see the tears my mother sheds. If she could only hear her mother pray again. My grandmother. My grandmother was petite in her stature, but don't let that fool you. She still had the power. I remember I stayed there 1 week, and Nan made me sit at the table for 3 hours while I struggled to finish my bowl of shreddies. I remember getting hit in the head for not walking properly, for scuffing my feet. But I also remember the joy I had when I knew I was going to visit her. She was so very important to me, the head of our family. I think about her not being there when I walked across that stage at my grade 12 graduation. I remember sitting in the back of the church about a month before, wishing so badly that she could be there. I think about how she will not be there physically to share in the important things in my life. I also think about how she loved our family, how she brought joy to us all. I think about her house on the mountain, as they called it in New Glasgow. I think about how she set an example, how she put God first. I remember her smile. It could light up a room. I remember her skin so soft. Like a baby's bottom, not a wrinkle one. I remember her loving touch. I remember her chocolate cake, the best around in my opinion. I recall after her stroke, she was not very mobile and she couldn't get to the store. She was unable to purchase the things that she wanted, such as gifts. But she always made it a point to slip me a 20 when Mom wasn't looking. I was so angry when she passed when I was younger. I was so jealous of my cousins because they were mostly older and they knew her longer and could recall more memories. But as I got older, I came to realize it was a blessing that I had a chance to know her at all, the chance to be in her presence. I now have a locket that occupies her picture alone because she deserves my whole heart. I wear it as often as I can. That way she will never miss anything good or bad. My very heart would beat if I could hear my grandmother pray again.
There's an incredible conversation that has taken place in this room. At the beginning of June, we gathered and some of you were here then to celebrate the opening of the exhibit that's along the mezzanine, which is called On the Road North, Black Canada and the Journey to Freedom. And those of you who can see past the sail of the Blue Nose sloop here, which I can't right now, will see that hanging up there is a wonderful quilt, which we call the North Preston Freedom Quilt. And it was created by North Preston grandmothers. And they're here, some of them. And I'd like you to stand up. To sail to freedom. And as we were talking about this, they talked about how they wanted to use this quilting, which they had learned from their ancestors, from their grandmothers, to express to their children and grandchildren how important it was to keep ancestor values alive. And these two poems by Natasha and Nicole must be incredibly heartening to you because they speak to just what you were longing for when we talked a few months ago. It's wonderful that these celebrations uncover the fruits of freedom in surprising ways. And that's very much to be celebrated. Also to be celebrated is the incredible Marco Simmons.
The song that I'm about to do is an original song. And the title of the song is Rise Again. Just to put a plug in there, my CD, I've been working on it, and it will be coming out this September. Amongst all of the other songs on the CD, there's one song that speaks about encouragement, and this is the song it's called Rise Again. I share, you can rise again.
just you wait and see, you can rise again. If you just believe, no matter how hard it gets, no matter what you see, you can rise, you can rise again. Come on, everybody out there, if you can, clap your hands, come on. Yeah. Struggles in your life says you'll never find a way. With quiet segregation, your life it slips away. The dreams of your night seem to never see the day that will bring you joy and peace along the way. But if you just hold on and hold on to your faith, no matter what the people say, remember you have the strength to go on and be strong. With you, my message today, you can rise again. Just you wait and see, you can rise again. If you just believe, no matter how hard it gets, no matter what you see, you can rise, you can rise. Now is the time you can find your way. Now is the time you can see your day. Lift yourself up to walk on stormy seas. And when I'm down, I'll sing this song for me. You can rise again. Just you wait and see, you can rise again. If you just believe, no matter how hard it gets, no matter what you see, you can rise, you can rise, you can rise again. Just you wait and see, you can rise again. If you just believe, come on, no matter how hard it gets, no matter what you see, you can rise. I know you will rise again.
Listen
to my brother, rise again. To my sister, rise again. I want you to know you can rise again.
Please help me welcome now the captain of Amistad, Captain Sean Burkhall.
I may be the captain, but the vessel only works with a great crew, and that's what we have here. So we'd like to have the Amistad crew come up. I want you to know that you guys have done something I haven't been able to do. You've gotten to get all dressed up. I've been trying for several days, and I give you commends to that. And we could go through and introduce by name as well. We start from the far end. We have Mike, who's here all the way up from Philadelphia, right? Philadelphia. Philadelphia. And next to Mike, we have Isaac, also known as Hank. And next door, we have Sam. And Sam's actually from Sierra Leone. And next to Sam, we have Sawyer. And then I'm having a mind blink here. Yeah. Oh. Sawyer's from Wisconsin. Where are you from?
Hey, all right. Okay.
And then we have Kyle from Los Angeles. That's it. Where are you from? Okay, and then we have Tom from New Hampshire. I was so excited about New Hampshire.
You're from California. Santa Barbara, yeah.
And we have Baron from Santa Barbara, which is actually where I'm from as well. Where are you from? And we have Miriam from Delaware. And there's a few other members of our crew, but they're down taking care of the ship, but they send you their best. Thank you. Oh, there he is. Okay, and we have Sebastian from...
Cornelius, from
Connecticut, New Haven. Thank you. Put him out. Also. Thank you very much.
When I was on the when I was on the wharf the other day, looking up at the top of the masts, there was Tom and Sawyer, and somebody said, "Oh, there's Tom Sawyer," and doing a very Tom Sawyer sort of thing. It would be there's lots to celebrate in the Amistad's visit. And the Amistad is here to help us celebrate this marvelous anniversary of the abolition. But it would be an incomplete story were I not to mention the fact that Amistad is here despite the fact that they are undergoing incredible cash flow problems, which are the result of the spin-offs of the global financial meltdown. And in truth, if Amistad had been prudent, and if they had been looking only at the bottom line, they would have abandoned this month-long visit to Nova Scotia with its celebration of our important story and the opportunities for them to do workshops and sales with 250 Nova Scotian young people and to participate in so many ways in keeping the story of freedom alive, because they are, I've described it often as sailing along a tightrope over a precipice. But because they were, because over the past 4 years, we have become family. And we have realized how inextricably our stories are interwoven, that they decided to risk coming here even though their situation is dire. I think there's a bit of the faith that we will rise again that enlivens the people at the core of Amistad. But I want you to know that these people who sail with Amistad are heroes. These people are heroes because the ship doesn't sail from head office. The ship sails because the people who are on the crew are there every day making it happen. So we owe them our thanks. And we also want to thank people who have responded to a special plea for additional help. Sitting here in the front row is Bishop Sue Moxley from the, she's the bishop of the Nova Scotia and PEI Diocese of the Anglican Church of Canada. She has always been a supporter of Amistad, and she came through again in the crunch. The Craig Foundation, Garson McDonald, lawyers, Craig Garson especially, and the Black Loyalist Heritage Society, Elizabeth Cromwell and Bev Cox. Let's thank them all. There's a special young man from New Haven, Connecticut, who's on Amistad as an intern. And as I was thinking of the development of this evening and the ways in which we were calling upon the poetry of Shauntay's students to help us to celebrate, I realized that Cornelius Washington, who loves to dance, he has a form of physical poetry which is greatly to be celebrated. So please help me to welcome Cornelius Washington, along with a familiar face, Dr. Henry Bishop. Before we move on, just mention the extraordinary group who we have leading our youth workshops. And today, we had a remarkable workshop with our Jamaican visitors and some senior leaders and some young leaders for freedom. So the genius who makes this all happen is Charla Williams. Where's Charla? She's ably assisted by Nina Cox and Jeremy Martell. Okay. And Haley Cox. Haley Fox. Haley Cox and Nina Cox are Black Loyalist descendants from Shelburne who took part in Amistad's Atlantic Freedom Tour. Haley sailed from London or from Liverpool, England, to Freetown, Sierra Leone, and Nina sailed from Senegal through the Caribbean to Charleston. Wow. One of the exciting things that's happened recently in Nova Scotia's political life is that the Honorable Percy Parris is now the minister responsible for African Nova Scotian affairs. And also for the Maritime Museum of the Atlantic. The Honorable Percy.
Now that all the exciting stuff is, this is a little bit of a break because now you get to listen to me for the next couple minutes, kind of slow things down here a bit. High Commissioner, Minister Moore, MLAs Michelle Raymond, Lenore San, and Jim Boudreaux, Councillor David Hensby, Sean Bear Shan, Captain La Amistad, Colonel Frank Lumsden, ladies and gentlemen, youth, honored guests, one and all. As the minister responsible for the Office of African Nova Scotian Affairs and the Department of Tourism, Culture and Heritage, the Department of Economic and Rural Development, and the Nova Scotia Business Incorporated, I bring greetings on behalf of the province and Premier Darrell Dexter. It is a pleasure. It is a pleasure to be here with you this evening to once again welcome the Freedom Schooner Amistad and certainly the crew to Nova Scotia. We also welcome to our province for the first time, the Charlestown Maroon Drum and Dance Troupe. The stories of persons of African descent is a story of hope. It is a story of courage, and it is a story of determination. So, it is fitting these two groups with deep historical connections to our province grace our shores as we mark the 175th anniversary of the abolishment of enslavement in the British Empire. As many of you know, the Amistad story tells of 53 Africans who were illegally kidnapped from West Africa, sold into the transatlantic slave trade, and taken aboard La Amistad in 1839. They eventually revolted, taking over the vessel, and after an historical U.S. Supreme Court ruling, the survivors won their freedom. Almost two centuries later, the replicated schooner's owners, Amistad America, stayed committed to creating dialogue around issues of human rights and diversity. They used La Amistad's history to teach lessons of freedom, of justice, of resolve, of cooperation, and leadership. And they take their mission seriously. Recognizing the need to have youth involved, the Freedom Schooner Amistad is a floating history lesson for youth taking part in a number of its programs. In fact, this year, over 75 youth from across Nova Scotia had had the chance and the opportunity to train and sail aboard the schooner. We are also pleased the Charlestown Maroon drummers and dancers from Charlestown, Jamaica, are here to celebrate this anniversary with us and connect their history to our shores. This story may be new to some, but it's certainly not to us. Formerly enslaved by the Spanish, the Jamaican Maroons battled their British colonizers for over 140 years. Defeated in 1796, 600 exited for Nova Scotia. They exited in exile. While here, they worked on the fortress Citadel Hill, but after 4 years, due to the harsh winters, many left for Sierra Leone in Africa. But a few remained, and their ancestors can be found here in Nova Scotia today. Under the direction of Colonel Frank Lumpston, the Charlestown Maroon drummers and dancers preserve, showcase, and celebrate the Jamaican Maroons' centuries-old musical heritage and culture, making these types of international connections vital to the African Nova Scotian community. It deepens our roots and provides answers to historical questions. It also explains the history of this culturally rich province and highlights African Nova Scotian contributions in its growth. The Charlestown Maroon drummers and dancers are hitting a series of concerts in Metro beginning tomorrow evening with special local guests that include Pope Laureate and one of my favorite people in all the world, Shauntay Grant, and the jazz ensemble of Harvey Miller and B. Sharp. There are also several opportunities to interact with the freedom schooner Amistad while it's docked at the Maritime Museum of the Atlantic. I encourage you to experience the courageous and uplifting stories they both have to offer. Enjoy the rest of the evening. Thank you.
The fourth group and final group of Shauntay Grant's extraordinary students are Letitia Fraser and Lamera Reddick. Please help me to welcome them.
Every Sunday after church, we would go to my grandfather's house for supper. As soon as I step in the door, little cousins attack me. But through the crowd of nappy heads and cornrows, I see my grandfather's toothless smile. Little Rosie, he calls me, because he can never remember my name. I hug him. His beard scratches my face. At night, when he's had just enough to drink, he pulls out his guitar and sings some gospel tunes. There will be peace in the valley for me someday. There will be peace in the valley for me, O Lord, I pray. I wanted to stay and listen, but me and Mom had to leave, not knowing that this would be the last time I would see him. One September morning, a cousin tells me that he has passed. My heart races as I get into her car. My vision went blurry. The only thing I could see was his face. The grandfather that hit me with the switch, the grandfather that yelled when I touched something simple, the grandfather that I thought I was mad at forever, was gone. No more little kids dancing to his music. No more cigarette smoke in the air. No more daddy. At his funeral, I cried. People next to me cried. His children cried. I tried not to look at his body, but it was too hard. I wanted him to open his eyes. I'm not even sure he knows how much we all miss him, but I know that I'll never forget him for the rest of my life. Daddy, this poem's for you.
Sounds like a calling, telling everyone to come, Faster, 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 get there faster. A gathering. Our people have come to celebrate, celebrating the fact that we are still here, in spite of the many struggles we have endured, in spite of the many whippings our ancestors received. We are still here, in spite of the Black loyalists and the Black refugees' painful journey to get here to Nova Scotia. We are still here, in spite of their attempts to isolate us once we arrived, putting us up in the woods and giving us nothing but prejudiced stares and racial comments. We are still here, in spite of all the agony and all the pain, and still, we gather. People dancing, whining, and grinding, grinning ear to ear. When I look out at my beautiful people, everything becomes clear. This is who we are, and this is what we do. Our bodies have the ability to move to the beat, on beat. We cannot let this celebration come to an end. We had to keep it alive by remembering. We had to remember our past and continue to celebrate how far we have come. And we also need to educate our little ones. All we have to do is remember. Please remember to keep this celebration alive. It sounds like a calling, telling everyone to come faster. Faster, faster. Thank you.
So much, Leticia and Lemaya. Now I want to introduce you to a remarkable woman who was the spark and the energy behind the audacious idea of bringing the Charlestown Maroon drummers and dancers to Nova Scotia, where some of their ancestors came and some of their cousins still live. Please help me to welcome Her Excellency. Why don't I start this again? Please help me to welcome Her Excellency Evadne Coy, Jamaican High Commissioner to Canada.
Minister Paris, Minister Moore, members of the Legislative Assembly of Nova Scotia, councillors, ladies and gentlemen, Jamaicans, Amistad, it's wonderful to be here. You know what it feels like when you have a dream and you have no idea how you're going to bring it about? And you try and you pray for a solution, and the open door you think you saw suddenly shuts, and you look for the window and it's not there. You know how it feels when you think, okay, I know this has got to come together, so let me bump the credit card up a bit and hope the sponsorships will roll in. You know how it feels when you get a commitment from a sponsor who then remains silent, and you bump the credit card up a bit more, being faithful to the faith. You know how it feels when finally you sit in a room like this and you have the Amistad and you have the Charlestown Maroons and you have Nova Scotia, and it's a confluence of historic significance that's come together, and you know the dream has come to pass. That's a feeling which I don't think I get very often, if at all. It's a feeling when you know that you have come to a point because so many people have bought into the dream and have worked with you to make it happen. I came here several months ago to sell that dream in Halifax, and it wasn't very hard. But when I was trying to sell that dream, to the African Nova Scotian Society, I then became aware that Amistad was going to be in town, and I got so excited because I saw the three parts of this coming together. The Amistad representing freedom, the struggle for freedom, the struggle never to accept slavery. The Maroons who fled slavery and fought to remain free, fought the British with their armies, fought until the British were forced to sign a peace treaty which recognized them as an autonomous people within Jamaica. We have our own Vatican City, though it's not religious. And the Maroons across the years have struggled to retain their culture. And I'm not saying preserve, because it's more than that. They have sought to grow their culture by mingling with the people of the coasts from which their ancestors came to Jamaica, by learning from those in other countries who have also retained something of the Africa of the 15th and 16th centuries. And they're here in Nova Scotia, where they have come in celebration, celebrating the fact that they have come free. They have come to help us celebrate the 175th anniversary of slavery, despite the fact that they did not remain in slavery, to have experienced in themselves that emancipation. And they have come at a point in time when that celebration is joined to the celebration of the freedom of the Amistad. At a point in time when they can, as it were, redeem the bloodlines of their forefathers who came here as exiles, who came here at a time when, though there was no slavery, racism was alive and very well, when they suffered the ignominy not of slavery, but of abject discrimination. It was not just the cold, ladies and gentlemen. It was the need to feel human again, which drove so many of them to join the ships which were going to Sierra Leone. And there, they contributed. Today, there is a town called Maroon Town in Sierra Leone. There is Maroon Hill. And the Maroons made for themselves a name there. And which was why I wanted one other part of that puzzle to come together here. And it's just the one disappointment which I did not, well, I didn't manage to achieve that. We wanted to bring the High Commissioner of Sierra Leone here to celebrate with us this evening. But unfortunately, he had to do business of his country at a meeting of the African NAPAD, can't remember the name of it right now, but NAPAD, which is an inter-African group for development, and they're meeting in Nairobi. He asked me to express his regrets that he would not be able to be with us, but to say that his spirit lives with us in this meeting. So, ladies and gentlemen, my dream, which started when we celebrated the 174th anniversary, when I said we have to do something spectacular to bring the Charlestown Maroons to celebrate with us in Halifax, to redeem the ancestors' blood, as it were. And that dream has come. Now, I have to thank a lot of people. I want to thank the African Nova Scotian Affairs. I want to thank the African Nova Scotia Music Association. I want to thank John. When I first heard of him, I thought he was Chinese. I couldn't think of Shu being anything else but Chinese. And I want to thank the Jamaican community here in Halifax and the environs. But there are also people outside of this area who have helped. Without the help of the Bank of Nova Scotia in Toronto, I would not have been able to bring the group from Toronto to Halifax. It's important that the Bank of Nova Scotia got themselves involved, because that bank was the one who allowed the trade between Jamaica and Nova Scotia, where you people got the beautiful rum and molasses from Jamaica. And we enjoyed the codfish, the salted cod, so much that salted cod has become a part of our national dish. Can you imagine, therefore, when the Canadians decided to have a moratorium on cod fishing, what was going to happen to the national dish of Jamaica? Well, the thing is, cod does not need visas. So the cod went down towards Portugal and Spain. I'm not going to say they came up for it. And we managed to get our cod in that way. But the Bank of Nova Scotia established their first outpost in Jamaica. I think it was in 18-something, early 18s. And it has remained the most profitable branch of the Bank of Nova Scotia anywhere in the world. So, you know, I thought that it would have been a logical fit. My hope was that they would have borne every single cent of the costs. But times are hard, and I'm very happy. I'm very happy that they came in. Air Jamaica also was very helpful to us. The Jamaica Tourism Development Fund, they helped us. Jamaica National Building Society helped us. And a Canadian firm which has been doing good business in Jamaica, Dassault International, also is one of our very important sponsors. Rotary Club Ottawa also helped us. So a number of people and companies and firms came in. Then we had what we call a 1-1 cocoa full basket appeal. Jamaicans, you know what that means, right? It means every little bit that you put into a basket will fill it. So we had that appeal, and Jamaicans from the Greater Toronto area, from Ottawa, from other places contributed. So I do believe that at the end of the day, I might be able to pay off my credit card debt. So thank you all very much. It's been a pleasure being with you. It's been a pleasure sharing the dream with you.
What a wonderful evening. What wonderful poets and musicians and visitors. What a wonderful audience. Give yourself a hand. I want to thank Ariel's Catering. Ariel's Catering. And I want to say that I'm just going to call out a wonderful guy at Dartmouth Dodge, Shane Coward. Shane Coward. Coward has, at the last minute, managed to provide us a van to service the visit of the Amistad, and Shane also provided me with some cards. So if you ever want a good car, come and get Shane Coward's card from me. Enjoy the rest of the evening. Marco's going to play some more. I think there's food. There's wonderful people around here to talk to. Enjoy.